Dear friends, having gone through the generalized coordinates in previous lecture, today we shall develop the notations for displacement, velocity, momentum, force, and potential or potential energy in terms of generalized coordinates. In fact, these notations are very useful in developing the Lagrangian equation of motion. So, in this lecture, we will discuss these five notations, which are, as I have told you, generalized displacement, generalized velocity, generalized momentum, generalized force, and generalized potential. We will discuss each of these notations in a particular sense, particular manner, as we will see these notations. In these notations, first of all, we are considering generalized displacement. Generalized displacement. Let us consider there is a system of n particles. These dots represent the different particles, and due to some cause, our system suffers a configuration change. When the system changes its configuration, you say that the system is suffering a virtual displacement. Let us consider here is an ith particle, and its position vector with respect to an origin O is ri, and due to some cause, its position changes and this position becomes this, and the particle suffers a displacement, let us suppose delta ri. This delta ri is known as virtual displacement of ith particle. Remember, whenever we talk about the virtual displacement, definitely it takes place at a given time. It means, in case of virtual displacement, time is always specified. Now, in terms of delta ri, we will explain the idea of generalized displacement. But how? Let us proceed. We have considered n equal to number of particles in the system, n is number of particles in the system, and let us suppose f is degree of freedom of the system. F equal to degrees of freedom of the system. when you say f is degree of freedom of the system, what does it mean? It means to describe the configuration of this system, we will need f independent coordinates or f generalized coordinates. And those generalized coordinates, as we have represented in previous lectures, that will be represented as q1, q2, so on, qf. If the degree of freedom is f, we will have f generalized coordinates to describe the configuration of this system. Now, as we have written the transformation equation in previous lecture, discussing the idea of generalized coordinates, we can express the Cartesian coordinates in terms of the generalized coordinates and possibly time. The transformation equation connecting these two sets of variables we have studied already. So let us write it. The transformation equation. Transformation equation. As we have studied in previous lecture, if Ri is the position vector of ith particle of the system, then this Ri is expressed as a function of all the generalized coordinates, that is q1, q2, so on, qf and t. We have already studied in previous lecture this very transformation equation. Now we have to find virtual displacement of the ith particle. We denote the virtual displacement by the symbol delta ri. So we can find mathematically what will be the virtual displacement delta ri. Delta ri, in fact, this is infinite simal change in ri. And here you see that the function ri is a function of not only one variable, but in fact it is a function of f plus 1 variable. F plus 1. How f plus 1? F is the number of generalized coordinates and one variable is time. So there are f plus 1 independent variables of which ri is a function. Since ri is a function of more than one variables, so if you want to calculate or if you want to find the small change or differential change in ri, we must follow partial differentiation. And I hope you have studied in calculus the partial differentiation, and so let us do it. Delta ri, what will be delta ri? This will be simply del ri del q1. Here at first we differentiate with respect to the first variable q1, taking the other variables constant. As we are finding delta ri, so here will be the term delta q1 plus del ri del q2. Delta q2 and so on plus del ri del qf delta qf plus. Now we will differentiate with respect to t. Del ri डेल आ रहा है, डेल टी, डेल्टा टी, डेल्टा टी। लेट अस सी दिस एक्सप्रेशन। इन दिस एक्सप्रेशन वी शुड नोट ए वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट। एज आई हैव टोल्ड यू दैट वर्चुअल डिस्प्लेसमेंट इज ऑलवेज कंसिडर्ड एट ए स्पेसिफाइड टाइम एट ए गिवन टाइम। इट मीन्स वर्चुअल डिस्प्लेसमेंट इज कंसिडर्ड considered at a given time. It means time is fixed, given time. And so the term delta t, which represents in fact infinite simul change in t, this will be zero, since virtual displacement is considered at a particular time, at a given time, or at a specified time. So in this condition delta t will be zero. So in above equation the last term will vanish because delta t will be zero, and so the remaining terms from q1 to qf will be in our expression. And you can write this expression by the use of sign of summation in brief. Hence the above equation can be written as what we may write the above equation. This will be delta ri equal to del qk. Here we have taken a subscript k, you can use another subscript like j, like l, and so on. In my forthcoming lecture I will always use this subscript for convenience. Here the index k is repeated, and the index which is repeated, summation is implied for that index. So remember, here summation does not mean for the subscript I. I is fixed, that you are considering the ith particle. But the subscript k is repeated, so summation is implied for that k. And you know k has a value from 1 to f, where f is degree of freedom. So limit of this summation will be simply k 1 to f, k equal to 1 to f. In fact, this is a transformation equation between the two displacements. Delta ri is displacement or virtual displacement in Cartesian coordinates. And this delta qk is also a displacement, and this is known as generalized displacement. Delta ri, this is displacement in Cartesian coordinates or you have told that this is virtual displacement. And what is this delta qk? This is what which I have to know. This is in fact generalized displacement. Because you know that qk is generalized coordinate, and so the infinite simul change in qk, that is generalized coordinate, is generalized displacement. And this equation relates the displacement in Cartesian coordinate and displacement in generalized coordinate. Here, one thing must be remembered, an important point you may note down, that delta QK is generalized displacement and delta RI is also displacement, but in Cartesian coordinate. You know delta RI has always dimension of length. It has dimension of length, but it does not mean that delta QK, which you have called generalized displacement, it will also have dimension of length always. It is not necessary. Delta QK may or may not the dimension of length, that is L, its dimension may be L or may not be L. Why? How you can say that its dimension may or may not be L, dimension of length, how you can say? In fact, see the above expression. The dimension of delta QK will depend on the dimension of QK. And we know that QK does not need to have always a dimension of length. And so delta QK also does not need to always have a dimension of length. If QK has dimension of length, then delta QK will also have dimension of length. So it is obvious from the above expression that delta QK does not need to have a dimension of length always. Its dimension may be dimension of length or may not be dimension of length. For example, if we consider QK is an angle. It is an angle. It may be an angle. It may be momentum. It may be velocity. It may be any electric charge. Let us suppose QK is angle. If QK is angle, then delta QK, this will be angular displacement. Angular displacement. And as you know, angle has no dimension. And so in this condition, delta QK will be also dimensionless. If QK is angle, then delta QK will be angular displacement and it will be dimensionless. So this was all about generalized displacement. I hope you have understand the idea of generalized displacement definitely. Now we will talk another important notation, which is called generalized velocity. Next important notation is generalized velocity. Generalized velocity, if you want to define the generalized velocity, you can define it just like in Newtonian mechanics you define the velocity as the time derivative of position vector is called velocity as we define in Cartesian coordinates or in Newtonian mechanics. But in terms of generalized coordinates, definition will be same. We simply define that the total time derivative or the ordinary time derivative of generalized coordinates are generalized velocities. For your convenience, I write this simple definition. Total time derivative of generalized coordinate is generalized velocity. Total time derivative means ordinary derivative, not partial. So if Q is generalized coordinate, if Q is generalized coordinate, then generalized velocity is denoted by Q dot, and this Q dot will be defined by dq by dt. This is ordinary derivative or total time derivative of generalized coordinate Q. Now let us consider a system having f degree of freedom. F equal to degree of freedom, of our system. We consider a system having f degree of freedom, or in other words, you can say f is the degree of freedom of the system under consideration. As you know, if f is degree of freedom of the system, definitely there will be f generalized coordinate to describe the configuration, to describe the motion of the system. And those generalized coordinates are denoted by the symbol q1, q2, so on, qf. So f is degree of freedom, then q1, q2, so on, qf are the generalized coordinates to describe the configuration of the system. If we consider f is degree of freedom of our system, in that very condition, there will be F generalized coordinates Q1, Q2, so on Qf to describe the configuration of the system. And in this condition, the generalized velocity will have F components. It means corresponding to each generalized coordinate, we have a generalized velocity or a component of generalized velocity. So there will be F components of generalized velocity if the degree of freedom is F. And what will be those? In this condition, there are F components of generalized velocity. Generalized velocity denoted as, in short, you may write QK dot equal to dQK dt. QK dot equal to dQK dt. Here, as you know, K is equal to 1, 2, so on F. So, substituting the different values of K, you will get all the F components of generalized velocity. Therefore, we may write Q1 dot. What will be Q1 dot? This will be dQ1 dt. Just like that, Q2 dot, this will be dQ2 dt, and so on. Now, we will relate the velocity of a particle in Cartesian coordinate and the generalized velocity. Or you may say, this is the transformation equation, how we can find velocity in Cartesian coordinate if we know generalized velocity. So in this condition, there you may say two things, and both are identical. First of all, we can say that we have to relate the velocity of a particle in Cartesian coordinate and generalized velocity. Or in other words, you can say that relation will be simply a transformation equation to transform the generalized velocity into velocity in Cartesian coordinate. We will start from the transformation equation as we have used in case of generalized displacement. Transformation equation. Transformation equation. As we have seen above, that when we express the transformation equation between Cartesian coordinate and generalized coordinate, what is that transformation equation? We have used it so many times. Ri of Q1, Q2, so on Qf and T. Now here we have to find velocity in Cartesian coordinates. And as you know, simply that time derivative of position vector is velocity in Cartesian coordinates. So if we differentiate this ri with respect to t, we will get the velocity in Cartesian coordinate. So ri dot, this is velocity in Cartesian coordinate, ri dot, which will be in fact defined like this, dri dt. Now again see here, ri is again a function of f plus 1 independent variables. So to find the derivative of ri with respect to t, we must follow the rule of partial differentiation. And you have used it so many times. Now hope you will not feel any trouble in understanding this concept. So let us see what will be the result in this case. First of all, ri will be differentiated with respect to q1, del ri del q1. Remember, here we have to differentiate with respect to t. So now I will differentiate q1 with respect to t. Now differentiation will be with respect to q2, supposing the other variables constant, and that will be del ri del q2 dq2 dt plus so on plus del ri del qf and dqf dt dqf dt dqf dt and plus. Now differentiation will be with respect to t, and this will be del ri by del t and dt 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 dt. You can see dt dt will be equal to 1. So the above equation can be written as, let us understand some steps in your mind. Except the last term, the first f terms you may write like this. This implies ri dot equal to ri dot equal to del ri del q1 q1 dot dq1 by dt, that will be equal to q1 dot, plus del ri by del q2 q2 dot plus so on plus del ri by del qf qf dot dqf by dt. This is written as qf dot. Remember, when differentiation is with respect to t, I use the symbol dot for that. And plus the last term, as dt dt is 1, so in last term we will be left with del ri del t. and we can simply write it as Ri dot equal to, except the last term del Ri by del t, the sum of the first f terms can be written by the use of sign of summation like above. You may write del Ri del Qk, Qk dot, del Ri del Qk, Qk dot, where summation is implied for k which runs from 1 to f, and plus the last term, that is in fact del Ri del t. This is in fact the transformation equation or a relation between the generalized velocity Qk dot and the velocity in Cartesian coordinate Ri dot. Let us see some important facts regarding this result. First of all, we have to see one thing. As in case of generalized displacement, I have told you that it is not necessary to that generalized displacement has always dimension of length. So, as you know, in Cartesian coordinate, the dimension of velocity is what? It is simply meter second inverse or LT inverse. In Cartesian, coordinates, dimension of velocity, is meter second inverse, or you symbolically say it as LT inverse, in Cartesian coordinate. But dimension of generalized velocity, does not need always to be LT inverse. In fact, its dimension will depend on the dimension of Qk. Qk decides the dimension of generalized velocity, and as Qk may or may not, have a dimension of length. Qk's dimension may be length or it may not be of length. So, dimension of generalized velocity is not necessarily LT inverse. For example, let us consider Qk represents momentum. You know, generalized coordinate may be any quantity, it may be momentum. If Qk is momentum, then then QK dot will have dimension of force. As you know from second law of motion, force is equal to dp dt, and here we have considered qk as momentum, so dqk dt or qk dot will have dimension of force. Now one thing here we have to note is very important regarding the above transformation equation. As you see, the transformation equation defined in equation number 2. In this equation, we see that the Cartesian components of velocity ri dot are the linear functions of the generalized components of velocity. It does not depend on how the generalized coordinates get changed. This means it is easy to express the velocities in generalized coordinates rather than Cartesian coordinate. So you may remember the relation between generalized velocity and the velocity in Cartesian coordinate as expressed in equation 2 is a linear relationship, and this linear relationship does not depend on how QK changes, and due to this fact, due to this cause, the determination of velocity in terms of generalized velocity is more convenient than the determination in Cartesian coordinates. So I write only some important point regarding this for your convenience. The second important fact, equation 2 refers that ri dot and qk dot are related linearly. You see, in RHS of equation 2, there is a term del ri by del t. What does this term refers? In fact, the term del ri by del t appears only when there are constraints depending on time, or in some cases where it is convenient to introduce moving coordinates. The term del ri del t in RHS of equation 2, when does this term will appear? It appears when constraints are time dependent. Or if we consider the moving coordinates, in that condition this term will appear. So regarding the generalized velocity, these were some important facts. We must remember these facts or must understand these clearly. Now we will discuss the third generalized notation, and that third generalized notation is most important notation, that is called generalized momentum. How it is defined? In fact, in simpler form, you can define generalized momentum as a partial derivative of kinetic energy with respect to generalized velocity. For your convenience, I write this simple definition: partial derivative of kinetic energy of a particle or system particle or system partial derivative of kinetic energy of a particle or system. System is defined as Pk equal to del T del Qk dot. We define the generalized momentum as a partial derivative of kinetic energy of a system or of a particle with respect to generalized velocity. As you see here, Pk is equal to del T by del Qk dot. This is the basic definition. Remember, this definition also gives some information to us, which will be noted by you. Pk equal to del T by del Qk dot. Regarding generalized momentum, just like generalized velocity or generalized displacement, first thing we have to note down is the momentum, generalized momentum, does not need always the dimension of MLT inverse, as in Cartesian coordinate, its dimension is MLT inverse, but generalized momentum will have a dimension of MLT inverse or may not have a dimension of MLT inverse. MLT inverse may or may not be the dimension of Pk. Generalized momentum can have a dimension of MLT inverse or it may not have a dimension of MLT inverse. For example, you will see that this generalized momentum may be angular momentum. And if it is angular momentum, in that condition its dimension will be ML2T inverse, not MLT inverse. It may be angular momentum. And then its dimension will be what? Its dimension will be ML2T inverse, not MLT inverse, but ML2T inverse. So it is obvious that the dimension of generalized momentum may or may not be MLT inverse. If it represents the angular momentum, its dimension will be ML2T inverse. Let us clear it by an example. In point number 2, we consider an example. Let us consider a particle of mass m moving in a plane, and we describe the motion of that very particle in plane polar coordinates. Let us say the particle is moving in xy plane, or you may say r theta plane, and at any time t the particle is at a point P, and the plane polar coordinate of this point is r and theta. Let us suppose. Now, with respect to this reference frame, we can define the kinetic energy of this particle. If m is mass of the particle, and let us suppose at any time t its speed is v, in that condition kinetic energy of the particle moving in r theta plane, moving in r theta plane is given as t equal to, remember we denote kinetic energy in classical mechanics by the symbol t. You may use the symbol k, but for convenience in most of the text the symbol t has been used. So t, if v is the speed of this particle at any moment t, then what will be the kinetic energy of that particle? You know the classical formula for kinetic energy. This will be simply t equal to half mv square. As we have considered the particle is moving in r theta plane, so here the velocity of the particle will have two mutually perpendicular components, and those are called radial component and transverse component. Now, velocity of the particle v equal to vr r hat plus v theta hat here, what is VR? VR is radial velocity. Radial velocity or radial component of velocity. And V theta, this is called transverse velocity. Remember, if we consider the motion in xy plane, it means we are dealing the problem in Cartesian coordinate, then here will be the symbol Vx and Vy. But as we have considered the plane r theta, it means we are using plane polar coordinates. So in this condition, the two mutually perpendicular components of this velocity vector are Vr and V theta instead of Vx and Vy. You call Vr radial component of velocity or simply radial velocity, and V theta as transverse component of velocity or simply transverse velocity. You must know Vr is equal to dr by dt. And this V theta, this is r d theta dt. Here one thing we must remember, here r hat, this is a unit vector in increasing direction of r. This is called radial unit vector. And theta hat is the unit vector in increasing direction of theta, and so it is called a unit vector in transverse direction. This is also a, or you may say transverse unit vector. This is in fact transverse unit vector. Now, if in dot symbol, we can write this expression in a simple form. Velocity vector V will be equal to r dot r hat plus r theta dot theta hat. This is in fact velocity vector, and so we can express the kinetic energy of the particle in this polar coordinates as, so what will be the kinetic energy T? This kinetic energy T will be equal to half m V R square plus V theta square, and you see here that modulus of Vr is simply R dot, and that of V theta is R theta dot. So the expression will be half m R dot square plus R square theta dot square. This is in fact expression for kinetic energy of our particle. Now here there are two generalized coordinates, one is R and another is theta, and we can define the generalized momentum with respect to these two generalized coordinates. Here in this example we have first generalized coordinate q1 is equal to R, and the second generalized coordinate q2 is equal to theta. And as you know, generalized momentum is defined with respect to generalized coordinate. Since there are two generalized coordinates, so there will be two components or two values of generalized momentum, and corresponding to R and theta we can define these momentum. Corresponding to R and theta, the generalized momentum. The generalized momenta, momenta is plural form of momentum, momenta, R. Generalized momenta R. The first one, with respect to R, we will denote the generalized momentum by the symbol PR. And as in the light of above definition, we will define it as del T by del R dot. The general definition is PK equal to del T by del QK dot. Here at the place of PK there is PR, and so corresponding to PR the generalized coordinates is R, so definition of PR will be del T by del R dot. Now put the expression for T here as you have defined above it, del R dot, and T as we have defined it, it is half m R dot square plus R square theta dot square. R square theta dot square. Let us see here. We have to consider partial differentiation with respect to R dot. So except R dot, all quantities will be treated constant. Hence, the differentiation of this second term will vanish. Only we'll have non-zero derivative of this R dot square. And what will be the result? The result will be half m into R dot square. We have to differentiate it with respect to R dot. That will be 2R dot. and dc of this term with respect to r dot will be 0 because it is partial differentiation. And so we have pr is equal to what? This 2 and 2 will cancel out. This is mr dot. And as you see, pr equal to mr dot. Mr dot, r dot is velocity in Cartesian coordinate and this is mass. So this is simply momentum in Cartesian coordinate and you call it linear momentum. This momentum is called linear momentum. Now we will define the another generalized momenta with respect to the second generalized coordinate, that is theta. Relative to theta, relative to theta, generalized momentum. Generalized momentum p theta equal to, in accordance with the definition, what will be this? This will be del t del theta dot, because here theta is the generalized coordinate. And so by definition we will define the generalized momenta corresponding to this generalized coordinate theta as del t by del theta dot. Again you put the expression of t and simplify it. This is del del theta dot, and expression for t is half m r dot square plus r square theta dot square. We have simply put up here the expression for kinetic energy. Again, you see here half m is a constant factor, so it will be outside of the differential operator this much. And inside the bracket, there are two terms, but in this expression, we have to differentiate partially with respect to theta dot. So only theta dot term will be differentiated and the term containing r dot square will vanish because it is partial differentiation. And so this will be what? R square into 2 theta dot. Again this 2 and 2 will cancel out. So what we get here? We get p theta equal to m r square theta dot. You know m r square theta dot simply defines angular momentum. So in fact this generalized momentum is angular momentum. Angular momentum. Now I hope the concept of generalized momentum has been clear to you. But here we should note a very remarkable fact. Regarding the generalized momenta. Just as a remarks, we can note it that generalized momentum, as we have studied above, does not need always have a dimension of MLT inverse, but it may be MLT inverse. As in this example, you see here, this angular momentum has a dimension of ML2T inverse. ML2T inverse. But one thing we should remember, whenever we take a product of a generalized momentum and the conjugate or corresponding or associated generalized coordinate, definitely that product has a dimension of angular momentum. Our dimension of angular momentum is same as that of a dynamic variable which is called action. In forthcoming lectures, I will teach you regarding action. We will study principle of least action, and action has a dimension of angular momentum, and you may say it has a dimension of Planck's constant. So this is a very important fact. The product of, for your convenience, we just write it in short, the product of any generalized momentum and the associated generalized coordinates. Associated generalized coordinate, and associated generalized coordinates are also called conjugate coordinate. The product of any generalized momentum and the associated generalized coordinate must always have the dimension of angular momentum. Angular momentum, or the dynamic variable which is called action, which will be further described in detail in forthcoming lectures. Action, and action has a dimension of product of energy and time, or linear momentum and length, that is angular momentum. So this must be remembered. If P is a generalized momentum, or PK is generalized momentum, and QK is generalized coordinate. With respect to QK, we define PK. In this condition, this PK can have a dimension of momentum or cannot have a dimension of momentum. But whenever we take the dimension of product of QK and PK, if you take dimension of product of QK and PK, this dimension will be always ML2T inverse 2. This is what which I have written here. This is the fact. The dimension of the product of any generalized coordinate and the generalized momentum corresponding to that generalized coordinate will have always the dimension of angular momentum. Now we will consider the next important generalized notation, that is of generalized force. Generalized force. Generalized force. To define generalized force, let us consider again a system of particles consisting of n particles, and this system has f degree of freedom. As you have told it so many times, f is degree of freedom of the system, n is number of particles in the system. And let us consider an ith particle under consideration. This is our ith particle, and let us say a force Fi is acting on this ith particle, and due to this force Fi, this ith particle suffers a virtual displacement, say delta Ri. F, this is degrees of freedom degrees of freedom n number of particles in the system Fi. What is Fi? This is force acting on the ith particle. Ith and delta Ri, this is in fact virtual displacement of ith particle. Virtual displacement of ith particle. Rather, we also say that summation over Fi, summation over Fi, where I runs from 1 to n, n is the total number of particle. This is force on the system, you may say it. And instead of considering the virtual displacement of a single particle under consideration, that is ith particle, we may take that summation delta Ri, summation delta Ri for the same limit I want to n represents the virtual displacement of the system. Virtual displacement of the system. Virtual displacement of the system. In this condition, as you know from the very basic definition of work, work is simply the scalar product of force acting on the system and its displacement. So, work done. Work done by the forces acting on the system. Acting on the system. If we denote this work by W, in most of the text, delta W symbol is utilized, but the beginners feel some confusion, which I will tell you in fourth coming section. So I don't write delta W, but we use the symbol simply W for the work done. We know if we consider work done by the force Fi acting on the particle, ith particle, then this work done will be Fi dot delta Ri. And if you take summation of this for the limit I 1 to n, then this will be total work done by the forces acting on the system. We know this delta Ri is what? This is virtual displacement as we have defined in the case of generalized displacement. So perhaps I have written that equation 1. So from there you may write it. Now I am writing it directly as you have seen it in equation 1. Delta Ri. Delta Ri. This equal to summation over k 1 to f del Ri del Qk delta Qk delta Qk. Let us put this expression here. So we will get W equal to what? This is summation over I. Now I do not write always I 1 to n, I refers 1 to n. Summation over I Fi dot delta Ri. And what is delta Ri? You have defined delta Ri like this, and so this will be Fi dot summation over k, and this k runs from 1 to f. Again, I am not writing here f. You may simply write k. And this will be del Ri del Qk delta Qk. We have simply substituted the value of delta Ri in the above equation. Now, The order of summation may be interchanged. Our result does not get affected from that. So here we just interchange the order of summation. Let us take first summation with respect to I to be run first, and then summation with respect to K. So let us take summation over K and summation over I Fi dot del Ri by del Qk into delta Qk. Let us see here the bracketed term. This bracketed term is denoted by a particular symbol. Here the order of summation is reversed. There should be F here. This is correct. This is I. Because index I repeated, so here the index will be I. And this bracketed term is denoted by a particular symbol. We denote it by a particular symbol QK. And this expression is written as W equal to summation over K, where K runs from 1 to F, QK into delta QK. You can see here that I have used the symbol capital QK instead of what? We simply see that here QK is equal to summation over I Fi dot del Ri del QK del Ri del QK. In fact, this quantity QK is known as generalized force, or more specifically you may say that it is the kth component of generalized force. QK is kth component of generalized force. So remember this expression, we will use it when we will study the Lagrange equation. This expression will be invariably used. So here QK represents the kth component of generalized force. One thing here we should note, that the dimension of generalized force again does not need always to the dimension of force. You must know dimension of force is MLT inverse 2. But this generalized force may or may not have the dimension MLT inverse 2. Because why it is so, we may explain from the above expression. तो क्योंकि मे और मे नॉट हैव द डायमेंशन एम एल टी इनवर्स टू. It may or may not have dimension of force, that is ML T inverse 2. Because as from the above equation, W has always dimension of work, that is ML T inverse 2. This should always have this dimension. And delta qk may have any dimension in ML2, not ML2 T inverse. Delta QK may have any dimension in accordance with our selection of generalized coordinate. As generalized coordinates are not fixed, it may have different dimensions. So delta QK has different, may have different dimension, but dimension of work is fixed. So definitely from above equation you may say that QK may have different dimensions. May have dimension different from force. The usual dimension of force, that is MLT inverse 2, the dimension of this QK may be different from that. Let us clear it by taking a simple example. We consider a force acting on a particle expressed in terms of plane polar coordinates. A simple example we are considering here. We consider a force acting on a particle, let us suppose F, and this force is expressed in terms of its two rectangular components, but those components are not Cartesian components but plane polar components. We write its radial component as FR, and the unit vector along FR will be R hat, and plus its transverse component F theta, and unit vector is theta hat. Here R hat and theta hat, this is radial unit vector, as you know it, radial unit vector, and theta hat, this is transverse unit vector. transverse unit vector. Now we can define the generalized force with respect to the two generalized coordinates. Here there are two generalized coordinates, one is r and another is theta, and we will define two generalized force or two components of generalized force corresponding to r and theta. Let us suppose corresponding to r, we denote the generalized force by the symbol qr, and in accordance with definition, how qr will be defined? You see here that how qk is defined. We see the definition of qk here. This is simply the scalar product of fi and del ri del qk. Here we are considering the radial component, so both vectors will be in same direction, and hence we here consider qr equal to f dot del r by del r. Del qk by del r by del r. As we know, this f is defined above, like f r r hat plus f theta theta hat and dot. This is del del r r times of r hat. Here we have written r into r hat at the place of vector r. As we are differentiating partially with respect to r, so this vector r hat will be treated constant, and differentiation will be of this quantity r, and so our result will be f r into r hat plus f theta into theta hat dot r hat del r by del r. You know del r by del r is 1, and what will be this product? R dot r hat dot r hat, that will be 1, and so the first term will be f r, but theta hat dot r hat will be 0. So qr is simply equal to fr. Here we see the generalized force qr is simply equal to fr, and this is in fact component of force in radial direction or in increasing direction of r. This is component of force in a radial direction, or you may say in increasing direction of r, radial direction or increasing direction of r. Now we will define the another component of the generalized force, that is the component with respect to the generalized coordinate theta. Let us denote this force by the symbol q theta, and this q theta will be what? This will be f dot del r by del theta. Here generalized coordinate is theta, so here will be theta, and this is equal to again f r into r hat plus f theta into theta hat dot del theta r into r hat. Remember, here theta is changing. It means we must keep r constant. When r remains constant and theta changes, this r remains constant and theta changes, then this radial unit vector will change and r will remain constant. So here our result will be f r r hat plus f theta theta hat dot r del r hat del theta, and this equal to f r r hat plus f theta theta hat dot r. You know del r hat del theta, in fact this is equal to theta hat. This is what? This is theta hat. This is theta hat. Now let us take the scalar product. R hat dot theta hat will be 0. So first term will vanish. And theta hat dot theta hat is 1. And so the second term will be non-vanishing. And the result will be what? This will be r into f theta. So q theta equal to r into f theta. You see here, this is in fact the product of length and force, which will have a dimension of torque. So this is torque acting in increasing direction of theta. So in this example you may see FR has a dimension of force, that is ML T inverse 2, but this Q theta has not a dimension of force, but it will have a dimension of torque, which is ML T inverse 2. It means dimension of QR, which is one of the component of generalized force, is simply MLT inverse 2, but dimension of Q theta is equal to dimension of torque, and that dimension of torque is ML2 T inverse 2, which is also the dimension of work or energy. So I hope it is now clear to you that the generalized force does not need to have always the dimension of force, that is ML T inverse 2. Now the last generalized notation we are considering is generalized potential. Generalized potential. I discuss this potential or this generalized notation in very short because in the forthcoming lecture I will explain this in very detail. So just for an information, I am not going thoroughly for generalized potential. In fact, in defining generalized potential there are two situations. One situation is the case of conservative system and another is the case of non-conservative system. So if the system is conservative, conservative system, as you know, in case of conservative system, the potential, whenever you say potential, it means potential energy. In fact, in higher physics, we always use the term potential instead of potential energy. You may call it potential energy, but when you say potential, it means potential energy. For a conservative system, the potential energy or the potential depends only on the position. If you denote this generalized potential by V, this V is a function of position only. Position only, not of velocity. But in case of non-conservative system, the potential is velocity dependent too. But if we consider conservative system, in that condition, as in Cartesian coordinate, you know, the conservative force is simply the negative gradient of potential energy. So here we say generalized force force QK may be expressed as minus del V del QK. But remember, this result is valid as long as we are considering the conservative system. But if our system is non-conservative, if we are considering non-conservative system. In that condition, the potential function is a function of velocity too. That is position dependent, also position dependent. But along with position, potential depends on velocity too. So it is also called a velocity dependent potential. In this condition, QK is not defined as in above equation. In this condition, we define the generalized force QK as minus del V del QK and plus d dt ddt, del u del qk dot. You know qk dot is generalized velocity. Qk dot. In this expression, the quantity u, which is in fact the quantity u, which is in fact velocity dependent, as you see here, u is differentiated with respect to qk dot. In fact, this u is called velocity dependent potential or simply generalized potential. So you may say u is what? This is velocity dependent potential or generalized potential. This is velocity dependent potential or generalized potential. In this way we have understood the different notations, some important notations as we have discussed. As I have told you, the last notation for the generalized potential will be discussed in more detail in forthcoming lectures. And you will see that these notations are very essential, very useful when we will derive the Lagrange equation. So when I will start the lecture on Lagrange equation, particularly its derivation, before that you must go through this lecture, and in your brain everything should be clear. And if it is clear, then you will understand the Lagrangian formulation in a very simple and very easy way. That's all. And in the next lecture, we will meet together with a new idea, with a new concept, and that will be also necessary for the derivation of Lagrange's equation.